Namaskar, good evening. You are watching Rajya Sabha Television. I'm Spriti Rastogi with News Tonight. Let's begin the bulletin with the top headlines. Sabarimala temple open to women of all ages, rules Supreme Court, ends a 800-year-old tradition, asserts that devotion can't be subjected to discrimination. Political parties and social groups call it a progressive verdict. On the second anniversary of the surgical strike against Pakistan, Prime Minister Narendra Modi inaugurates Parakram Parv in Jodhpur, pays homage to martyrs at Konark War Memorial, 51 cities to observe event to honour the bravery of the Indian Armed Forces till 30th of September. Environment of security essential to ensure cooperation and economic development in South Asia, says Sushma Swaraj at SAARC Foreign Ministers meeting, underscores need to eliminate the scourge of terrorism in all its forms by ending ecosystem of its support. Revamp higher education to bring it in tune with contemporary needs, says Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu. Underscores need to stop the trend of lakhs of engineering students graduating without basic employable skills, calls for efforts to combat educational challenges to build new and resurgent India. And GST Council sets up 7-member group of ministers to discuss steps to help states facing natural calamities. Move comes in the wake of proposal from Kerala to levy calamity tax to help raise additional resources in order to meet reconstruction costs after the floods. Our top focus tonight, in a landmark verdict, the Supreme Court broke gender barriers that prohibited the entry of women between 10 to 50 years of age into Sabarimala temple in Kerala, calling the practice violative of the constitution. The court held that a patriarchal notion can't be allowed to trump equality in devotion.
Devotion cannot be subjected to discrimination. With this landmark observation, the Supreme Court opened the doors of Kerala's Sabarimala temple to women of all ages. In a 4-1 verdict, the 5-judge constitution bench headed by Chief Justice Deepak Mishra ruled that banning the entry of women into the temple is gender discrimination. The bench said a patriarchal notion cannot be allowed to trump equality in devotion, adding that the custom of barring women from a place of worship violates Article 25(1) of the constitution that promises freedom of conscience and the right to freely profess, practice and propagate religion.
We welcome the judgment of Supreme Court. Now, the entry of women is not banned, and the practice which was going on there, it was very derogatory. So I am glad it has gone. It has been set aside.
We have only represented women's organizations here. And these are women who have faith in the temple, who have faith in their prayers. So as far as I am concerned, the majority view has let down the believers and people who put faith in the tradition.
For centuries, women of menstruating age were restricted from entering the Sabarimala temple as its deity, Lord Ayyappa, is considered to be a celibate. However, the apex court said devotees of Lord Ayyappa do not constitute a separate denomination, observing that any exception placed on women because of biological differences violates the constitution. Chief Justice Deepak Mishra said the practice of excluding women in the 10 to 50 age group cannot be regarded as an essential religious practice. Justice Indu Malhotra, the lone woman and dissenting judge in the 4-1 verdict, said it is up to the worshippers and not the court to decide what should and should not count as essential practices in a religion.
ദേവസ്വം ബോർഡ് തന്നെ ചർച്ച ചെയ്യേണ്ടതായിട്ടുണ്ട് മൂന്നാം തീയതിയിലത്തെ ബോർഡ് ആ പ്രശ്നം ചർച്ച ചെയ്തിട്ട് ആവശ്യമായിട്ടുള്ള നിലപാട് സ്വീകരിക്കും
As interveners in Supreme Court, we will definitely go ahead with this fight because it affects the very core of temple belief and temple systems. Article 25 will be diluted. Every temple, every church, every mosque will lose that particular right of self-governance and self-regulation. We need to get the details, but definitely in 1 week or 2 weeks' time, before the temple opens, we will give review petition to the Honorable Supreme Court.
The PIL filed in the Supreme Court contended that not allowing women to worship in Sabarimala temple violated constitutional guarantees. Ravindra Singh Shoran's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
The Supreme Court declined to appoint a special investigation team to probe the arrest of five right activists in connection with the Koregaon Bhima violence case. Declining to interfere with the arrest, a three-judge bench headed by Chief Justice Deepak Mishra refused the plea seeking immediate release of the activist. The 2-1 verdict said the accused persons can't choose which investigating agency should probe the case. The court also extended the house arrest of all the five activists by 4 weeks. Activists Varavara Rao, Arun Ferreira, Vernon Gonzalez, Sudha Bharadwaj and Gautam Navlakha are under arrest at their home since 29th of August. Maharashtra Chief Minister has welcomed the Supreme Court's decision.
अब पुणे पुलिस सुप्रीम कोर्ट के कहे अनुसार एप्रोप्रिएट कोर्ट में जो सारे एविडेंसेस है वो देगी और उन एविडेंसेस के आधार पर मैं ऐसा मानता हूं कि निश्चित रूप से इनकी कस्टडी हमको मिलेगी और ये जो देश के खिलाफ साजिश है इसका पर्दाफाश करते हुए देश के साथ जो लोग देश की सुरक्षा के साथ देश के जन जन के साथ जो लोग खिलवाड़ करते हैं उनको निश्चित रूप से सजा देने का काम पुणे पुलिस के माध्यम से होगा।
And reacting to the Supreme Court's decision, BJP President Amit Shah targeted Rahul Gandhi for supporting urban Naxals and politicizing the issue of national security. In a series of tweets, Amit Shah said that the Congress stands exposed with the order of the Apex Court in the Bhima Koregaon violence. Shah also asked the Congress to clear its stand on the critical issue of urban Naxalism. 3-day mega celebrations have been planned to mark the second anniversary of Indian Army's surgical strike against terrorist hideouts across the line of control. Prime Minister Narendra Modi inaugurated the 3-day Parakram Parv in Jodhpur to pay homage to the martyrs. Defence Minister Nirmala Sitharaman inaugurated the 3-day event at the India Gate lawns.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi inaugurating the Parakram Parv exhibition at the military station in Jodhpur. The event marks the second anniversary of the Indian Army's surgical strikes across the line of control. After arriving at the military station, the Prime Minister signed a message paying homage to martyrs and took a round of the exhibition that showcases combat capabilities of the Indian Army. The Prime Minister also paid floral tributes to martyrs at the Konark War Memorial. He was accompanied by Defence Minister Nirmala Sitharaman and Rajasthan Chief Minister Vasundhara Raje. The Prime Minister and the Defence Minister also attended the Combined Commanders Conference at the Jodhpur Air Force Station. The 3-day event that showcases the courage and sacrifice of the armed forces is being held at 53 locations in 51 cities across the country. The main event on the India Gate lawns in Delhi will have movies and photographs will be shown. There will also be digital signing walls for sending messages to soldiers. Letters addressed by school children are also on display, as also captured weapons used by terrorists brought from Jammu and Kashmir.
Indian Armed Forces prove to this world that there is a very clear way in which we will show our strength to say that we shall not tolerate. We proved to them that that shall not go unpunished. And when it shall not go unpunished, what is the action that we would take? It's all out in the open now. All the terrorist pads were cleared off. And those who were wanting to spread terror have been adequately punished.
The army had carried out surgical strikes on the night of September 28th, 29th in 2016 on 7 terrorist launch pads across the line of control as a response to an attack on its base in Uri earlier that month. The army's special forces inflicted significant casualties on terrorists waiting there to cross into Indian territory. The Uri attack was the deadliest attack on security forces in Kashmir in two decades. 17 Indian soldiers were gunned down by four heavily armed militants on the Indian Army Brigade headquarters. On the eve of the second anniversary, the government released a fresh video clip of the surgical strikes. The clip that was made using overhead footage from UAVs and thermal imaging shows a terror launch pad being destroyed. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
On to some more developments. The GST Council will set up a 7-member group of ministers to discuss measures to help state facing natural calamities. Finance Minister Arun Jaitley said the panel discussed the proposal from Kerala to levy calamity tax, a special tax or cess to raise additional resources aimed at meeting the cost of reconstruction in Kerala in the aftermath of floods. The GOM will examine the legality of imposing a new tax on certain goods and services to help raise resources. On revenue position of the states, the finance minister said, the states faced an average 16% shortfall in GST mop-up in the first year of implementation. The shortfall has come down to 13% during April-August period of current fiscal.
इस 14 से उनका रेवेन्यू कितना शॉर्ट है ताकि जब हम पांचवें साल को कंप्लीट करें तो वो उसके बराबर में आ जाएं। तो इसका पहला ट्रेंड ये नोटिस हुआ कि नॉर्थ ईस्ट की कई स्टेट्स हैं जो इस क्राइटेरिया को मीट कर चुकी हैं और अगर 3-14% जोड़ लिए जाएं तो उनका प्रेजेंट कलेक्शन उससे ऊपर हो गया है क्योंकि डेस्टिनेशन टैक्स का प्रिंसिपल था वो मैन्युफैक्चरिंग स्टेट्स हैं नहीं वो कंज्यूमिंग स्टेट्स हैं तो इसलिए वहां ये इंप्रूवमेंट हुआ है जो दिस इज द फर्स्ट साइन ऑफ इनकरेजमेंट इन दैट सेंस लेकिन एक जो मैंने कहा ऑप्टिकली लगता था कि जो पहली 5-6 स्टेट्स हैं जहां पे टैक्सेशन इस 14% के अगर 3 इंक्रीमेंट कर लिए जाए तो कम हुआ है तो उनके रीजंस को रेवेन्यू सेक्रेटरी उन 6 में से 5 स्टेट्स में गए और एक डिटेल रिपोर्ट हर स्टेट की प्रेजेंट की है कि इसके पीछे कारण क्या है और उसके स्पेशल सर्कमस्टेंसेस डिस्कस करने की कोशिश की है एक थ्रेड जो कारणों का कई स्टेट्स में मिला है कि कुछ स्टेट्स में स्पेशल टैक्सेशन हुआ करता था 15-16 में
And Home Minister Rajnath Singh has said that local body polls in Jammu and Kashmir will be of historic significance in many ways. He said this while help re-establish the long overdue grassroots democracy. In a statement, Singh said that centre will provide all possible support including central forces for smooth conduct of polls in Jammu and Kashmir. Elections to local bodies in Jammu and Kashmir are due next month. Meanwhile, both the major political parties in Kashmir, NC and PDP, have decided to boycott the elections to local bodies owing to the pending case on Article 35A in the Supreme Court. Information and Technology Minister Ravi Shankar Prasad launched the Centre of Excellence for Data Analytics. The minister said that National Informatics Center will help the government leverage data analytics to make data-driven decisions and will further strengthen delivery of citizen services with the help of its Center of Excellence for Data Analytics. The center will support various departments of utilize insights from huge amount of data generated as a part of various government's governance processes. The minister also launched DigiVarta, a mobile-based app. DigiVarta is a platform designed to enable financial and social inclusion by educating citizens on various schemes and programs. Home Affairs,
Government of India. ये सब आप 4-5 साल में देश के बदलाव के क्षितिजों को आप देख रहे हैं मैं उसकी अगली कड़ी के रूप में इंडिया इमर्जिंग एज ए बिग सेंटर ऑफ डेटा एनालिसिस देखना चाहता हूं इन विच एनआईसी हैज टू प्ले ए वेरी पिवोटल रोल ये हमारी अपेक्षा आप लोगों से है
And with that, we'll head into a very short break. More news and updates on the other side. Stay with us. Welcome back. Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu on Friday said that universities need to overhaul syllabi and teaching methodologies to make them relevant to the needs of the industries. He was addressing the fourth convocation of the National Institute of Technology, Panaji, in Goa today. Naidu said, perseverance, honesty, empathy, patience and self-belief will enable students to realize their dreams. The Vice President said, as engineers, it is important for students and youth to take a closer look at the collective needs of the populace and come up with innovative, cost-effective solutions, especially in the areas like healthcare and education. Stating that India is poised to become a high middle income country by 2030, the Vice President said a lot of opportunities will be waiting for the skilled youth in different sectors. The Vice President said that undesirable trend of lakhs of engineering students graduating in India without basic employable skills must stop. Naidu also stressed on the importance of education, saying it is not just for employment but also meant to empower, enlighten, widen the perspective of students and develop them into global citizens.
There are ample opportunities, new challenges coming in. We are in an era of LPG, liberalization, privatization, globalization. Globalization provides you opportunities, but also throws you challenges. Because the competition is wide. New ideas, new innovations, new thoughts, new experiences, everything is available. And moreover, we are in an open country. FDI is allowed everywhere. Now ease of doing business is a thrust. So a lot of investments are coming, other companies are coming, so competition will be more in life, but it will also bring opportunities in life.
Housing and Urban Affairs Minister Hardeep Singh Puri inaugurated an international conference on plastic recycling and waste management today in New Delhi. The minister's address emphasized on solid waste management and asked industry to adopt recycling of plastic waste. He said the marvel material of one-time plastic is now choking the ecosystem and societies. It must self-regulate before it becomes a menace that could further bring into a mass movement against it. The minister further added that urban rejuvenation has to be green and sustainable, and government's flagship programs, including Swachhata Mission, are already making their impact in this way.
We are going to go into the green and resilient mode. My ministry is having a global construction technology challenge this year, when we will invite people from all over the world, economic entities which are into sustainable green technologies for the purpose of construction. And what we are planning to do is to invite them then to participate.
External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj today held a meeting with the SAARC foreign ministers on Friday and said that the scourge of terrorism remains the single largest threat to peace and stability in the South Asian region. She asserted that it is necessary to eliminate the ecosystem of its support. The External Affairs Minister emphasized that regional cooperation can only be successful if it meets the expectations of the people. Sushma Swaraj also underscored that in order to realize the region's immense potential for trade, it was imperative that further trade liberalization under South Asian Free Trade Agreement and operationalization of SAARC Agreement on Trade in Services are done at the earliest. Calling cooperation in the energy sector critical for meeting high energy needs, she reminded that the SAARC Framework Agreement for Energy Cooperation signed at the 18th SAARC summit had not yet entered into force due to non-ratification by some member states. Chaired by Nepalese Foreign Minister, the meeting was held on the margins of 73rd session of the UN General Assembly. Russian President Vladimir Putin will be on a two-day visit to India from 4th of October. The Ministry of External Affairs confirmed on Friday the Russian President and Prime Minister Narendra Modi will jointly hold the 19th annual India-Russia bilateral summit in New Delhi. The summit will focus on boosting bilateral ties and deliberate on a range of regional and global issues, including U.S. sanctions on import of crude oil from Iran. Both countries are also expected to discuss ways to further deepen cooperation between the two countries in trade, investment, connectivity, energy, space and tourism. Both Russian President Putin and Prime Minister Narendra Modi are also likely to review bilateral defense cooperation in the wake of the US sanctions against Russian defense majors. Putin will also meet President Ramnath Kovind and take part in other official engagements. Well, that's all we have for you in this edition of News Tonight. For more news and updates, keep watching Rajya Sabha Television. Namaskar.